three guests of today's function. His Excellency, the Archbishop of Goa. Guest of honor, Mrs. Alina Santana, MLA of Courtenay constituency. Author of The Encounter, Dr. Sharmila Pai Shri Martinez, whose achievement we are celebrating today. Distinguished scholars and members of the audience, ladies and gentlemen. At the very outset, I thank Dr. Sharmila for this privilege. A privilege of participating and speaking at the launch of her very first book. I must reiterate and reinforce that her work can be summarized as being serious, sound, and scientifically written. Congratulations, Dr. Sharmila. If we look, or if we glance at the 450-year period of the Portuguese presence in India, to me at least, I could distinguish or see two distinct phases. The period from 1510 to 1750 as one phase, and the other period of 1750 to 1961 as the next phase. The first phase speaks about the fortunes of the colonizers, of the rulers, about Golden Goa, Goa Dourada, Portuguese political, economic, and cultural imperialism. Of course, towards the end, disintegration. Around 1730s or so, disintegration and collapse. And from then is the next phase, the phase of the rule of the colonials. From 1750 or a little later, maybe onwards till 1961. A phase when you hear the voice of the people. The voice of the people through representation, through constitutionalism, through parties, through self-expression, through revolts, through upsurges, through the press, and all this in the, mainly in the 19th and early 20th century, leading to the freedom movement. But yet when we look at the Indo-Portuguese literature and historiography, we see that still the emphasis is on the first period and just piecemeal work done on the second period. And if at all, much focus is done in anything of the second period is the freedom movement. And that too, beginning with Dr. Loya, as if nothing much happened before that. As if the Goans, whose period it was, had no voice still. Of course, had a very, very strong voice, which even did not exist in British India. Dating back to 1821, what was happening in British India in 1821 when we had our first constitution? 22, when we had our constitution, did British India have one? The mighty England was the country of democracy, but kept away democratic traditions and principles and practices from our empire, kept it away from that. Hypocritic. I don't see it as economic at all. I see it as hypocritic. But I'm not here in praise of Portuguese imperialism, please. I do not accept alien rule. But here we had in Portugal and in the overseas, including tiny Goa, which is still marginalized today, that time tiny, today also tiny, marginalized. We see that we had a constitution, we had representation, we had elections, we had parties, and all this is enshrined in Dr. Sharmila's book. The book entitled, as you can see, is entitled The Encounter with the Ballot in Colonial Goa, 1821 to 1961, 140-year period. Imagine 200 years back we started this whole process. The same thing which is happening today, the ballot, the elections, the parties, the electioneering, the campaigning, everything, 200 years back of 140-year period, dating to 200 years back, we all had all that. And are we aware of it? Are we celebrating it? Do we know it, or we want to ignore it? This is the question I'm posing today, and rightly and strongly and emphatically in 7 chapters of the book, this comes across very strongly. Contrary to all thinking that it was only, you know, when the constitution, first constitution came, that is in 1821, the constitutionalism came, and we had, contrary to the thinking that in the essence of the constitution, in a future work of mine, I examine this. And she's also, Dr. Sharmila also does it. Though there was some criteria for voting and for standing for elections in terms of age, in terms of taxation, in terms of, you could say, being the head of the family or so forth, but most right, and of course, I wonder why I'm a woman, because then also women, and today also women marginalized, women were excluded. This is only in a lighter way, please. Don't take me too seriously. But the issue was that the Hindus had not arrived, the Muslims had not arrived, the Parsis had not arrived. In the very first constitution, there was no barring of anybody, and it was not just the Catholics. That the general impression is, though, and this is in the very first constitution itself, and subsequently in the next constitution of 1826, that is the Constitutional Charter. And in fact, in her book, she has pointed out this very strongly, the involvement of other communities, including, that is, non-Catholic communities, right from 1836, to the extent that there were parliamentarians who are non-Catholics in the Portuguese parliament or the court. Very strongly in her group is the story of the electoral structure, electoral processes, the different parties with their ideologies and ideological strife, especially absolutists versus the liberals, or the moderates versus the radicals. And the later on, from 1865, caste comes into the picture, and especially the elite castes, that is Brahmins versus the Shardars. And still further, what shocked me is that we still had representation of some kind even under Dr. Salazar, the dreadful Dr. Salazar. And this was an eye-opener to me, Dr. Sharmila. Though I know a little bit, it may be touch and go about the 19th and 20th centuries, but this was the most fascinating element that even under Dr. Salazar, there were elections and there was representation, but that was from 1945 to 1961, when he knew that his days were numbered, when the days of the colonizers were numbered. That is when he thought he could make a few amends. Maybe it was a farce, but still we had representatives even in that particular period of time in the parliament. Then what then is the significance of this book? There is no doubt about it that it fills a yawning gap in historical writing on Indo-Portuguese history. A yawning gap, as I already said, very little work done, piecemeal work, touch and go work. There is no doubt about it, it's a great contribution to local Goan history. It's an eye-opener to the rest of India that what was happening here in tiny Goa. And so a contribution to the history of the Indian subcontinent, and a contribution to global history. And all this, the whole trajectory is under three governments. First, the constitutional government from 1821 to 1910. Then under the Republican setup of 1910, and then lastly under dictatorship of Salazar. All this, elections at all levels. Election, not only parliamentary elections, but elections at the municipal level, at the parish or the parochial level, to the legislative council. We have great names like Bernard Parrish de Silva, Francis Luis Gomes. We have people like Luis de Menezes in the legislative council. Then we have Lambertini, Presidio da Costa, or many, and Jeremias Mascarenhas, and many, many others, and Kenkro and Delpo. So what do we, all this new interesting facets where there were elections with exactly what was happening today, campaigning, rigging, landslide victories, and so forth, sensationalism, violence, the violent, what not is there to interest the common man as well as the very academic reader, everything. And so this is really, and this is a celebration. This book is a celebration exactly 200 years after the Constitution of 1821. We are in the year 2021. 200 years. Who has remembered about this? Anyone? I don't know if Portugal remembers. But no one has remembered. No one in India knows. No one in Goa knows. If you know, we have ignored it. COVID has kept us away, but not today for this celebration. I congratulate you, Dr. Sharmila, because your book also has given a lot of, reasons for future research. And the most important research is, again, between empires, with a new approach, between empires, that is, British India and Portuguese India. Compare this whole electoral process and all between British India and Portuguese India. Compare it with today's India, today's Goa. Compare this election. So these are the takeaways from the book. I really would like to congratulate you once again, Dr. Sharmila. Your work is a hardcore work, and you are a hardcore historian. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for a very patient hearing.